everyone, and welcome to the MBS Show Reviews. Today we're going to be reviewing the comics, the IDW comics issues number 11 and 12. That is the Princess Cadence and Shining Armor arc. Joining me today, I have Norman Sanzo.
Hello, I am Senior Norman Sanzo.
Oh, shut up, Norman. You're not going to talk today. And Lionheart Cartoons.
Hola, soy Senor Lionheart.
And Silver Quill.
I want Quantum Leap to show up in my high school.
I cannot believe that this comic actually made a reference to Quantum Leap. I was blown away.
Took me a while to notice that one.
I actually had to ask someone about this one. Oh my gosh. Okay, so out of all the characters that we were expecting to have a story arc of them all, of their own, I think Shining Armor and Cadence were the last ones we might be expecting.
True. I do understand what you mean, but I think this solidifies their existence, because in the cartoon they just pop up out of nowhere. Like, who are they? What are they? They're just toys. This is the reason why Lauren Frost left. Rah, rage. But with this comic in existence, I like them even more.
Let's go around the table, see what everybody thinks of these two comics in particular. I mean, because I don't know about you guys. I was checking the response that this comic got, and it's either you love it or you hate it. There is no middle ground with it. There is no people saying, ah, it's okay. And there are some people that just dropped their interest on the comics entirely, saying, ah, there goes my interest in the comics overall. And yeah.
Before we continue on, this was the infamous comic arc that spawned this guy on Twitter who tweets to Katie Cook telling her to educate herself with his fanfic.
Are you serious? That happened?
Yep, I'm serious. That did happen.
I had no idea of that.
And that guy is the bane of our existence.
I'm not even sure who this fellow is. He does not sound terribly smart.
Yeah, I know, but let's just say that what you say there, James, about people liking and not liking, it's true.
Yeah, there is no middle ground. Either you love the comic or you hate the comic. I don't see any other kind of reaction. Maybe we can bring in some new blood into this kind of argument, because I'm getting tired of just seeing extremes. I want to see something moderate.
Yeah, well, let's go around the table and
see what. So what everybody thinks. I'm going to save my opinion for last, like I always do. So what about you, Norman?
Well, like I mentioned before, I do like this comic because of how they expand Shining Armor and Cadence's personality and who they are and what they did in their lifespan. Like, even though we got little of them in the show, I do enjoy how they flush their characters out in this one.
I view the comics as a separate life, so I don't try to really judge the show by what happens in the comics and vice versa. For me, though, Cadence and Shining Armor, I don't hate them, but when I find out they're going to be in an episode, my enthusiasm level drops because I know not much is going to happen with them. In fact, I swear that the Crystal Empire is the empire of disappointment and underutilization.
Oh my.
But there are three Shining Armors out there for me. There's the show one, where he and Cadence are basically the Ken and Barbie of MLP.
Oh my.
There is the fan interpretation where people really flesh out him being a great brother and facing responsibilities of both Captain of the Guard and later Prince. You know, stuff where that this fandom excels at adding character. And then there's the comics, and I really enjoyed the take they put on Shining Armor. No one would have anticipated Captain of the Guard was the nerd in high school.
So that's
a fun twist. Now, Cadence, she had some good moments. She had a moment I really enjoyed where she defied the high school romance interest archetype. But she didn't get nearly the level of radical change that Shining Armor got. She sort of remained, you know, the perfect princess. with a little bit more fleshing out, but still not quite there.
Well, it was my first read-through about this. I'm not sure how all the characters have been developed in the comic and how much they cater to their show selves, per se. But I thought it was cute. It was a nice insight on something, well, a different take, I should say, from what I've seen both in the show. You know, the Ken and Barbie analogy was a nice one. I didn't really think yeah. about it that way, but it's true. And the fanfics, yes, they always do depict him either as a super overprotective brother or an overzealous guard. But, you know, essentially, not Mary Sue-ish, but very down to earth, if there's such a term for a unicorn, down to earth stallion. You know, he's there, he's doing his job as best as he can. You know, he's always super professional, but as a guard, you kind of expect that. And in the comic over there, it's a whole different aspect. Like Silver said, he's suddenly, you know, he used to be the nerd. I don't think he quite fits in there, but sometimes you have the guy that's a nerd but could also look normal. Essentially, they use all the sorts of stereotypes for the nerds, and suddenly there's shining armor in there. But he's like the exception to the rule, so it wasn't so bad.
True,
I
that.
Kind of enjoyed it. It was cute. It was really cute. Maybe I'm the wrong demographic for it, too, but at the same time, I do read comics. I've read a lot. And yeah, I found this one was quite cute.
Okay.
We're all supposed to be the wrong demographic.
True that.
Technically, yes, but it doesn't stop us from enjoying it when we can find the enjoyment in it.
True. Well, then again, this comic does do a few things that the target demographic of the TV show will definitely not get. but that's what happens when you have Andy Price and Katie Cook working on the comic together. They are going to throw shout-outs to everything. And they're gonna go, you know what this comic calls for? Let's put a pony in drag. Yeah, that's cool. That is something that we have seen in movies from the 50s and the 60s. That's something that happened especially in the 80s.
And 90s.
And yeah, almost every single high school movie had one of the nerd kids, usually the ugliest one, dressed in a drag. And he will always end up getting a partner in the dance because it's a funny trope.
Yeah, now that you mention it, there's a lot of throwback to Revenge of the Nerds.
There is a lot of it's very much like one of those National Lampoon movies if it got turned into a comic and it had ponies in it. it is very similar to it has an Animal House feel to it. That it's like, what will happen if ponies will go to high school? Well, these. And what if it was more PG? And that's it. Perfect. No problem. Like, that's... Okay, I'm dancing around the issue in that what I thought about the comic.
Yeah. So what do you think?
This comic is the anti-high school cliché in many aspects. I'm not sure about you guys, but I am sick and tired of those high school movies where the nerd is awkward and ugly and the queen of the prom is all pretty and full of herself. And then there is that lesson about the beauty seeing the inside and nobody sides with the nerd because he's a nerd, boo. And everybody wants to go with the cheerleader. One thing that TV show Heroes did so poorly, that it handled really badly. This comic destroys all of that. Like you said, yeah, the protagonist is a nerd, but Shane Armour is not particularly an ugly-looking guy.
True.
He hangs out with other nerds, and everybody likes the guy because he is helpful. He helps other with homework. Looking after their brothers, after their little brothers. Like, he is a good guy. And Cadence, she isn't even full of herself. Like, yeah, she's pretty and all that, but she doesn't consider herself super pretty or super important. And she happens to have a crush on the nerd. She doesn't have a crush on the football guy. She actually ends up going with the football guy because the nerd seems to be absent. So it's just, I'm like, every single trope that annoys me of high school movies. In these comics, they are destroyed. to the end of the bully or the football jock actually turning out to be a pretty nice guy at the end. Well, like, yeah, he learns his lesson, and there is a redeeming quality for him.
They show change in some characters. That's kind of what's interesting. Mm-hmm. But, you know, again, it's not like Cadence showed a huge amount of changes. Maybe she was prepped for this. No. I don't know what they were thinking. I'm not in the head of the writers in there. Mm-hmm. But, yeah, essentially, the only real stereotypes in there are Point Dexter. He's really the nerd stereotype, and the jock.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. They are the only ones, and they are harmless and, like, interesting enough that, and besides the joke, he gets, oh my god, that's a nightmare of a night for the guy. Like, the
poking the stuff, yeah.
Yeah, they keep poking him with a stick, then they throw him
Stygian Abyss?
Itching powder, and then they just, they rope him up and throw him against that moon thingy in the ceiling and they electrocute him. I'm like, oh my god.
But anywho,
that's a disco ball, I think.
Yeah.
It's a disco ball, yeah.
But anyway, James, I think a summary is needed for this.
Well, what kind of summary should we give for this one? It's just basically the backstory of how Cadence and Shane and Armor met up and how Cadence developed that bond that she has with Twilight, being told by Shane and Armor and Cadence. The first comic focuses on Shane and Armor's side, and the second comic focuses on Cadence's side. Mm-hmm. They are kind of like parallel stories that take place at the same time. They join in the middle, and then they end up united. What happens during that is makeovers at the same time as Magic the Gathering games, which it killed me. Was it Sorcery the Get Together, they called it?
They called it D&D. It was supposed to be a game of D&D, but what they call it was
Ogres and
Oubliettes and Monsters.
Yeah.
Ogres and Oubliettes.
Yeah, but if you go to issue 12, when the Cadence and her friends are setting up, at one point, hang on a minute, I'm looking at the comic. Yes, this. They are like, hey, we still have like 3 hours before we have to be at the dance. Want to play a round of Hocus Pocus to get together? Yes. And then at the same time, Cadence and her friends, they are like, we have to get ready. Ready in only 3 hours? We need to hurry!
Oh, boy. So, I think we're all over the place with this. So, let's try and see what we like about the comics. I mean, what scenes and whatnot, because we're all over this one, because you can clearly tell that we really enjoy this one. There's no denying it. Reading the comic and looking at what they are planning here was quite interesting. I mean, they're having a tea party, them eating fancy food and whatnot, and they complain about fancy foods, like we all should. Expensive, but in small portions. I wonder why. And, well, Fluttershy asked how did they meet up, like, how did they hook up? Which is a funny scenario when you think about it, like, how do you guys meet up? We are total strangers, we just met you last week, or last year. So how do you guys meet up? Pretty freaky, if you ask me. But, yeah, I mean, the whole setup, the whole drawing style, I love it. And Shining Armor, as a nerd, that surprised me. Total surprise. And I think cover for book 12 made me realize that I love Shining Armor even more, because in book 12 he has a royal purple dice bag. If you're a D&D player, royal purple is the way to go. Other than that, I don't know. I mean, the story is really interesting, and the reference in this comic is over the head for people who don't know geek culture. If you know geek culture, you are at home with this. And early 90s and late 80s callback reference to whatever, even the show Quantum Leap. Ah, that was so good. So overall, I love this book because of the story, the art, the references, and it's top quality from Katie Cook and Andy Price. And I also love the imagination scene for Shining Armor where they say they will live in a crystal palace. And I'm guessing that Andy Price asked his daughter to draw it. And it looks so cute. And it looks like it was drawn on that kind of paper.
You realize that later on the on Cadence's side,
yeah.
Then they have the same one, but yeah, while Shane and Armor look cartoony and kind of make with crayons, her looks like a Boris Vallejo painting. It's like super detailed, 3D, beautiful, and like striking. Oh my god.
But anywho, I mean, those are my thoughts. I like it, and art and whatever is really good. Silva, what do you think?
Like I say, I view comic Shining Armor as a different being from TV Shining Armor, but I really enjoy the comic Shining Armor. We're going to say this was a fun flashback, but this also touches on something I sometimes bemoan with Cadence in particular. Everything about her is a flashback.
Hmm.
She doesn't get to do anything in the moment, so all we can do is say it flashbacks of how she used to be awesome.
But you know, you know, I do hope that in season 5 they have a foil, because what, it's been how many, 2-3 years since they got married?
I'm still holding to it's only been a year since Twilight moved to Ponyville.
Mm. All right.
Yeah, so many things happening in 1 year.
Yeah, no kidding. Her social calendar must be crazy.
Yeah, or either that or Equestrian years last like 1,000 days.
Oh, God.
But all in all, I enjoyed Shining Armor's arc. The simple fact is that a character becomes fun when you get to see them have an emotional reaction. when you see that the world around them is having an impact on them and vice versa. So that great two-page spread where the nerd band, the Mystic Knights of the Electric Stable, I think it's written on the keyboard.
Yes.
You see a Philly vinyl scratch earn her cutie mark by watching Shining Armor.
Yeah.
All of these are great moments, and Shining Armor just gets so weepy-eyed when he thinks he's losing and Cadence isn't paying him any mind. You feel bad for him.
Yeah.
And that's what these comics do. These are the comics that made me feel bad for Hayseed Turnip.
Yeah.
I say that again.
Yes.
Hayseed Turnip. So by extension, Shining Armor is an easier sell. And then you have poor Spike watching on the Neigh Anything viewer saying, I hate to be that guy. Wait, I am that guy.
I am that guy.
Now, on Cadence's side, I didn't feel like it really fleshed her out as much. She's still the perfect princess. You know, everybody loves her. She's so sweet, although all we really get to see is that she shows some baseline decency when her jock friend trips everybody up.
Mm.
Now, the cynic within me, when Cadence and Shining Armor first share a panel together, ooh la la, Shining Armor is recounting that Cadence was a vision, I'm thinking, oh, she's casting her love magic on him.
Oh.
Because I'm that kind of a cynic. It's a funny thought. But Cadence
makes sense.
Well, that would mean she's brainwashing Shining Armor.
So she's a changeling now?
She was brainwashing before it was cool. Hipster Cadence.
Hipster Cadence.
But Cadence's strongest moment is when she first falls its Twilight.
Yes.
And that look in her eye as she grabs Twilight and says, tell me everything about your brother, then we'll make cookies and have the best night ever. It's like, okay, more of this, Cadence, please. And then, of course, there is that infamous panel, where is it, where Shining is getting ready for his flugelhorn
recital.
Yeah.
And everybody thought that Twilight's mom wrote Daring Do because this panel.
Oh, that one. Actually, there was a theory going on, and Katie Gore kind of like ascribed to that one, is that maybe there is a literary award called the Daring Do Award, and maybe Twilight's mom won it.
That doesn't mean that
she wrote Daring Do. And then she proceeded to say, later on future issues, they sneaked a detail in the background that said, if you are reading this detail, you are overanalyzing this comic.
No, but I do agree with what Silver's saying, because this comic came out before Daring Do, and also the revelation that Daring Do was actually a character. Like, she's not a fictional character, but a real
queen. She's real. Yeah, yeah, she exists.
So I do understand why people are overthinking it. And yeah, I mean, oh, she wrote Daring Do. Yay, awesome. But no, well, Daring Do is an awesome.
It's obvious that the comics and the TV show go different ways.
Yeah, but James, you have to remember, whatever is done in show would affect the comic. So it's show, comic, and then whatever merchandise left. And
well, it's a background detail anyway. They put Daring Do because within the universe of MLP available in the TV show, there is no other big literary master being written except for Daring Do. Unless they create something, a reference to Lord of the Rings, which could have been awesome.
And I do agree with what you said earlier, James, about what Katie Cook said about, in this world probably there's a Daring Do award, because if you think about it, Daring Do is a writer, an adventurer, and she writes one of the most popular books, so there's an award with her name on it.
I just realized that we completely crashed a Silver Quill, so
I'm sorry, Silver, but it was...
Sorry, dude.
Yeah.
I opened the floodgates.
Yeah, you did. We're sorry.
Yeah, but we shouldn't have, like, jumped on the let's talk about that.
No, but we almost fought on this, James. We almost fought on this.
It shows you how easy it is to get riled up on one simple background detail between both the people that say, oh, you shouldn't look too much into it, or, no, you should look into it. There has to be a middle point about this.
True.
From my perspective, I've never liked the phrase overthinking it, because that implies that you should stop thinking when you read the comics or watch the show, and I don't subscribe to that. I do believe in assigning more meaning than is really there. In that infamous panel that got us started, all it said was Daring Do on a plaque. Objectively, that's all it said.
Oh, true.
We assign a meaning to it. Mm-hmm. So yeah. it could mean 100 different things depending on who you ask. And then just since I don't want to take up too much time here, but I like that Cadence decided she wanted shining armor on her own.
Oh, yeah.
Most high school romance cliches, the love interest is this oblivious airhead who thinks she loves the jock, but then she realizes what a horrible person he is, and she suddenly sees the man she wants to marry in the last 10 minutes of the show. Here, Cadence knows what she wants, knows who she cares about, and she pursues it with a much simpler and more direct plan than what the boys are cooking up.
Yeah.
And so I'm all for that. And of course, there, as I already made mentions to the Quantum Leap reference.
Yeah. I was surprised. I discovered that one today. Out of all the time, today.
And I had to read it several times. Like, who is Al? Al? Wait, what? Al? Al? That Al? Not Al Bundy, but that Al. And then last but certainly not least is Gaffer's design, which is so unique. Gaffer is the orange pony with the white striping.
Oh, yeah. The one who got someone inside his brain controlling him. Yeah.
That is a very dark way of putting Quantum Leap, but I'll take it.
Why not, right?
But it's just so funny that there are horses that have that color scheme, but I'm guessing it's just a nightmare to animate because we don't see it very often.
True. And the same thing we don't see with, Pipsqueak in the show that much.
I'm not sure.
That kind of mottled pony design is not all that often, not that frequent.
True.
Although I want to throw this out to anyone who wants to design a pony OC, you don't need bat wings, obsessive scars, and alicorn status to look unique. Sometimes all you need is a splash of duotone across the face.
You have to be careful, because for every scar that you put in your OC, you win 15 points of Mary Sue. So be careful.
All right. So anyway,
colors and whatnots, and it's not that difficult. It's just that, for probably toy reasons, it's easier to just have something that's one color.
Yeah.
Yeah, and then there goes Cadence with her multicolor hair that is a nightmare to draw.
But anyway, Lion, what do you think?
Well, there's a lot that has already been explained, but there's a lot of interactions in there that do make them a lot more, a lot less 2D, I should say, than they are on the show. There's that wife-husband banter right at the beginning, and it's really cute. That really adds to some depth to their marriage. You know, they're not just husband and wife; they're also friends, and they like jab at each other left and right. And there's also that same brotherly and sisterly banter that goes in between. It's like, you'll never know. I have secrets. I know things that you don't. And, you know, it's always that little, oh, I'm going to get you to spill the beans sometimes, someday. It's those little things that add to the character. Twilight is already a pretty well-developed character in herself, but seeing Shining having that touch of personality is a nice extra, especially since he's mostly a zombie during the wedding. Mm-hmm. But it was nice. And seeing that he, as opposed to Cadence, yes, he does rely on his friends, but it's a guy thing. You lose all confidence when it comes to the feminists. You're dead. You never know what to do. And that really shows it very well. The expressions are really pushing it as well. That's really nice. Just, it cracked me up. Hello!
Hello!
He sees Cadence and she just, huh? What was that?
Nailed it.
He was so proud. There should have been a panel, you know, the Shining vision. She goes, hello! And in his mind, it's, hello. Wink, wink. Nod, yeah, nod, what's going, you know, brow, what's, brow.
What he thinks is happening, what is really happening.
Yes, that would have been a really nice touch. Like, everything goes wrong outside of his head. Yeah. In his head, he sees everything. That would have been a nice thing.
Because
you see it right after, like, nailed it, disheveled, everything, just hopping like an idiot. And he thinks everything is fine in the world because he said hello to the mayor of his dreams. I really like this. I read it, I don't know how many times, just, oh my god, they did this. Oh, that's so cute.
Yeah. I forget to mention one more thing. I only look at issue 11 when talking about this, but in issue 12, Celestia's appearance, even just a full panel, just one page, but it's the last thing she said that made it worth it.
Dump them the first chance you get.
Yeah. Yep.
Yes.
Worth it. But no, okay, so James, what about you?
I like how Cadence and Shane Arbor don't come off as unlikable characters. That is perhaps the biggest sin of this kind of story that takes place in high school. Let's all agree here and say that high school is full of
jerks
and people that just want everybody to be miserable. It's funny how both Cadence and Shane and Armor are the two characters that go out of their way to make high school a better place. Okay. And that is actually proved at the end when all of the high school decides to jump on Shane and Armor's side when Buck is acting like such an egotistical jerk, trying to take Cadence for himself, treating her like an object, and everybody just side with Shane and Arbor and say, no, he deserves to be the queen, the king of the prom, because he is a much better guy than you are. Mm-hmm. We don't care if your father is a Congress pony, you are an idiot. We hate you. And that was so good. That doesn't usually happen with, you know, these high school movies, they always end with the nerd making a speech at the end and saying, and because I'm different, you guys don't understand me, and I'm making you all feel guilty for treating me like this. No, it's actually, this happened before the story, and it feels so good in that they are characters you want to see together. You want to see them together. You want to see them, like, you want to see love succeed. As cheesy and corny as that sound, that sounds, you want to see them get together in the end.
Actually, I want to see Cadence reenact the scene with from Carrie. You know.
Perhaps
they did mention that, but this was too messy.
If the comic was done by Frank Miller, we might have ended up getting that kind of thing, followed by a massacre.
I'm sorry to derail, but I do need to bring up one thing.
All right.
They voted Buck as the prom king at first.
Mm,
yeah,
that's true.
And as much as I agree that Cain, Stein, Arma, they're shown to be very good-hearted ponies who are being nice in high school outside of their cliques, we're only told about that. We never get to see it.
Hey, Silver, I need to ask you, yes. Because I don't have those kind of problems, and I'm not sure about the rest of you guys, but how...
We don't have that kind of problem here in Spain. Right. At least when I was going to high school, we didn't have that kind of thing, because we thought it's not necessary.
Mm-hmm. So, Silver, how's the process like voting, who gets to be voted and whatnot? Like, what's the process? Could you run us through just a quick glimpse for the people who don't know how it works?
I love that you think I actually went to prom.
I mean, the whole voting thing. You didn't? No?
Not the whole voting thing. I thought prom was stupid. I still do. Well, it's a chance for everyone to get together, make a lot of noise, get drunk, and make a lot of mistakes.
Okay.
Oh, and inhale helium.
Oh, God.
Helium, that's classic.
Now, as I understand it, you can't... Basically... You put your name up on a list to see if you want to run for it.
Mm-hmm.
And then people make a vote before prom even starts. There's a little ballot drop-off box or some such.
Mm-hmm.
So my guess is that like 10% of the school actually gives a crud. All but right. It's a shallow thing. This is what kills me about the best night ever, greatest night of your life trope.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm afraid that trope is intact with this comic. I was kind of hoping they blow that one away as well. If you peak in your life peaks in high school on prom night, you've got to aim higher because it's all downhill from there. No, thank you. Hmm. And yet with all these high school movies and romance tales, we try to paint it that this is the night that determines the rest of your life. Bull. Absolute bull.
Hmm.
So, as you can tell, I have some strong feelings about this. But, so, long story short, I have no idea how prom works. I had no interest in how prom works. And I think I'm leading a pretty fun life without having gone that night.
Alright, I mean...
You say about breaking the trope of the best night ever, the best night of your life, to be known in that comic, remember that this is still... a comic that deserves to have a happy ending, because in reality, Shannon Arbor and Cadence, they got their happy ending. They both ended up living in a crystal palace together, living in happiness, sunshine, and rainbows. That ended up happening. That might be probably the, you know what, if they haven't got together in the end, if Cadence and Shannon Arbor were not together in the show, I'm pretty sure they would have destroyed that trope as well. But because they already have the ending established, they cannot do anything about that. However, they destroyed so many other tropes, and they broke so many other stereotypes. I am so happy that even Cadence's friends, the two other ponies that are with her, like preparing for the prom and all that, they don't try to convince her to go with Buck.
They want
him. Actually, one of them ends up going out with him, and I am so happy that they are not the type of, oh my gosh, that Shining Armor, he's such a nerd. Oh, he's so nerdy. I mean, he has to be so awkward and uncomfortable to be around. Like, no,
yeah, they didn't dismiss him right away.
Yeah, they didn't dismiss him. I mean, and that is true. The other thing you say, Silver, is that you don't see them being like that. You only read about it. You're only told about them being nice ponies by other characters. But I mean, does it really matter for the purpose of the story? That is just a seasoning on why they are such good ponies for the school. What matters is the love story between the both of them and putting them together. Yeah. Like, if you go ahead.
Okay, because I want to bring up 2 points on this. First off, with the happy ending is that they get together. So let me just throw an alternate ending at you. Their little bungee dismissal of Buck as he gets pulled towards a moon a la Luna.
Mm-hmm.
What if that, like, just brought down the effects? Everyone has to evacuate and the night is ruined. So Stranding Armor goes home feeling like he blew it at the end. Next morning, Cadence is at his front door, and they have a kiss on his doorstep.
That would have nice. That would have nicely too.
That would have been nice, but that would have like that's like artificially enlarging the comic for no good reason. And I actually am happy that the nerd's plan ends up turning better instead of ruining everything.
As it puts another pony at life in danger.
It is pretty obvious that everybody hates this jerk, so nobody likes Bug. And he's like, oh, he's dead? Good. I'm happy he's dead. I watched a Charles Bronson movie the other day, and it has one of the best moments where one of the bad guys gets killed, and everybody in the neighborhood is like, good, we're happy he's dead. He was a jerk. We hated that guy. So I am like, that's fine. Don't you tell me you had that bully in school that everybody wanted to see just getting his ass kicked and nobody dare to stand against him because he's the bully. He's going to kill you if you even try to raise a finger against him.
I do understand, and I also understand Silver's point of view.
Well, with getting to see the Shiny Iron Canes being a little more positive, sometimes it's just little things, and the old adage, show, don't tell, really does a lot. Because when you're told a character's really nice, that's what Twilight did in A Canterlot Wedding. She was saying, oh my gosh, Shining Armor's the best brother, and Keynes is the best full sitter. And I'm like, I can't care just because you care, right? I need something from these guys directly. And I'm just thinking of in issue 11, we have that fun scene where they're playing in what I assume is Shining Armor's basement. Or maybe Gaffer's. But what if that scene were, at least part of that scene were spent walking home, and Shiny Armor just does something nice for a passing pony who's, I don't cut carrying too many books or drop something. Just a little act to show that. And the audience, when the audience sees something, they immediately latch onto it. You hear it or read it, doesn't have the same impact.
I am less demanding about that when it comes to that kind of thing, but I can totally understand where you're coming from. It could have been a good thing to, like, having Shining Armor teach some, be at home and teaching some fall about, like, helping them with math or helping someone else with their homework. It could have been nice to see that. I agree with you, but again, it will derail from the purpose of the comic. I mean, the purpose of the comic, and it accomplishes this very well, is to make you care for Shannon Armor and Cadence, their love story, and how much they love each other, and how they have to get together, and the things that they have to put up with to end up being together. That's the purpose of the comic. It's not so much about fleshing them out as characters, though it kind of does that in the process. But you know what? It's always good that a comic makes you want more. Like, it leaves you wanting for more. Because that means that you care for the comic enough to say, you know what? I want to see more of this. When you go to see a movie or when you read a comic and you are like, oh, God, I'm so sick and tired of this. I need to move into other things. That's a failure of both the writers and the artists. If it leaves you wanting for more, that's kind of a good sign.
I agree on that, but I think we've cut Lionheart out of the conversation.
I'm sorry, Lion.
I'm still here. No, it's all right. I see what you mean. Show, don't tell is something that's very strong everywhere, but it has already been established that Shining is a good guy. He's captain of the guard. He's the best brother, blah, 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 BBBFF and all of that. Those who would buy the comic probably have seen the show, and it's somewhat already established that he's the good guy, so showing him doing even more good stuff might have been perhaps, I don't know, spreading it on too thick.
Probably, but you know...
Just my opinion on that. I didn't feel like it was out of place. Suddenly at the end, everything that could have been shown that he did is suddenly just put out in the open, but instead of concentrating on that, they decided to go and, well, he's with his pals, he's having fun, they're there for him. So he obviously does something right because they are willing to go to that extent to help him.
And yet none will be present at his wedding.
Really?
They're not. They're not. That is a good point, actually. They are not in the wedding.
That's true. We haven't seen them in the show.
I mean, granted, this came out after
the
wedding.
Or they're in the background.
So, you can't really expect it. But I was like, wait, what are these guys doing during the wedding? If they were in the background, did they run away screaming when Chrysalis showed up like everyone else? Oh, our best friend's been brainwashed to the stairwell!
Probably.
Oh no, critical miss!
Oh god, no!
Best friend is brainwashed. Quick, save, roll one for saving.
Save roll. Bad research on the part of the writers. Maybe they could have just picked something, because the Pegasus really does look like Thunder Lane.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, what was it? There's actually a card in the game that gives a name to one of the ponies in Shining Armor's on Shining Armor's side of the wedding. Let's see here.
Really?
CCG. Wow. I'll look into this, please. I'm sorry to derail.
All right. Anywho,
It's okay. We're going to make a cut here.
No worries.
Yeah.
Oh boy.
But as you might be telling already by the tone of the review, is that we all here like the comic, like the positive outweighs the negative in all of our opinions.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, right?
Yeah, I like it because, like I said earlier, the lovey-dovey scene between Cadence and Shining, it's really super kawaii.
It's really cute, and it's not overused. Mm. They could have just went with Big Mac and Cheerily. They could have just really been over the top, but they decided to focus on the story and the development. That's how they met. That's how things were. You've got the Shining perspective. You've got the Cadence perspective, mostly. So it's not the super awesome, but it was enjoyable. I laughed a lot. And that's a good sign.
From the very first time that Shannon Armour and Cadence showed up in the show, I have always been a supporter of them. I always liked them, never hated them. I cannot hate that kind of character. And is that the character that is good by nature, that they don't mean any harm to anybody. I mean, when I see Princess Cadence, the second thing that I see is a toy ploy. I mean, yes, she's there to sell toys. It is obvious that they put another alicorn in the show because they wanted to sell a pink princess toy.
Mm-hmm.
And that's it. I mean, that's what Cadence is there for. But that's not what I see. What I see is a supportive, good, like genuinely 100% benign and good-hearted character that is there to help others.
Oh, sure.
And I cannot hate that kind of character because I am a big fan of the lawful good character archetype that is very present in Dungeons & Dragons.
All right.
I like heroes. I like characters that are good by nature. And Cadence is the textbook example of that. I agree when people say, but she doesn't have any character. She doesn't have any flaws. They are presenting her as a perfect pony princess. Yes, I agree with you. I agree completely. And if you tell me that you hate her for that, I back you up. I am like, yeah, I completely agree with you.
It's like Silver said. I mean, the Cadence that just grabs Twilight. More of that, please. Yes, she even goes to the level of going. Yes, I've got the right stationery.
That would be great to see more of that. Yeah,
yeah.
It's like, this kind of paper is for Phyllis.
I got 37 covers of paper for my label marker. I always have an abacus with me just in case I need to calculate percentages for a pie chart. White ruled papers is for fools. Let's do this.
Suddenly makes stationery shopping kind of like a hardcore thing. All these good elements. Mm-hmm. I cannot hate anything on the comic.
Oh, true.
I have no complaints. I have no complaints whatsoever.
Mm. One more thing about this comic that is surprising, in timeline wise, this comic is actually in between number 9 and, well, it's supposed to be at 9 and 10, but they push this back because there's a line in book number 11 where they say that you're going to miss out on the summer wrap-up.
Really?
Yep.
Yeah, and they actually show Big Mac in the background looking for nails.
Yep.
And this will be the very last. This will be the very last time that we see Twilight as normal Unicorn Twilight in the comics. The next ones are gonna show her with her newfound alicorn wings.
Oh, and the brouhaha that caused.
Oy,
oh yeah,
that one.
Yeah. Oh.
So that's a professional term, brouhaha.
So
it's totally clinical.
Yeah, it's like bouillabaisse. It's like a huge jumble of stuff.
Or like bad juju.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, to be clear, I've probably been the most critical of our group about this comic, and I don't hate this comic. I did enjoy it.
Oh, man. That's true.
The points I bring up are just things I think could strengthen it and make it even more memorable. Because as it is, I still prefer Big Mac's Zen and the Art of Gazebo
over
Cadence and Shining Armor in high school. Because that wasn't a flashback.
Mm.
It's that whole everything I learned about Cadence has to be a flashback.
You want to push me on my opinion about the comic? I will say that the Nightmare Rarity arc is still better than the Princess Cadence and Shining Armor arc. And of course, Big Macintosh and the Art of Gazebo Reaper is my favorite. Of course, it doesn't get debunked.
Mm-hmm. I mean,
but for what we could have gotten, this is great.
Yeah,
I have no complaints about it whatsoever.
In terms of a book about Shining Armor and Cadence, it could have gone much, much worse.
Yeah. But, also, Silver, you are not being overly. Believe me, no. You're explaining your opinions way better than some other people I have seen throwing their crap at this comic, saying that it was horrible, that it broke everything, that it killed their interests in the official comics, and that it ruined their hopes for a better stories in the comics than in the show.
No.
So believe me, you are not being overly critical. You are actually being very sensible and very sound when it comes to this.
Thank you.
Yeah,
I mean, we can't be overly positive with reviewing. Then it'll be one-sided and it'll be not fair. But still,
exactly. We are not taking into account the things that make the comic good and that make the comic bad. I am disgustingly optimistic about everything.
Yeah,
we need to have some balance.
Yeah, and for me,
I've seen a lot worse in terms of comics coming from much more professional artists and script writers than this, really.
Mm-hmm.
This
one more day.
It was enjoyable. I didn't hate the art. Some places, like me, but I know how fast those things are made. And just pulling it off sometimes is quite a miracle.
Mm-hmm.
So,
I have to finish 4 pages in a week. I know exactly what it feels like.
Yeah, but still, I mean, the comic, if we're going to go a roundabout way of which is best in terms of the whole lineup, I would say that the Big Mac's The Zen of Gazebo Repairing is awesome. Like,
yes.
You have the first arc, the second arc, then the third arc, fourth arc. I mean, out of all four, I would say Big Mac and then Cadence, and then it would go to Chrysalis and then Nightmare Rarity. That's how I would go for the first four arcs.
If we are going for the first four arcs, I will go Zen and the Art of Gazebo Repair, the Nightmare Rarity arc, the Queen Chrysalis arc, and last but not least, the Princess Cadence and Shining Armor arc. And that means nothing, because for me, they are all 5 out of 5, 10 out of 10 story arcs. True. They are brilliant.
Yeah.
But then they all get debunked, because the next one, which is the Pirate arc, that is my absolute second favorite.
Well, technically there's the Equestria Girls issue, but we're not going to touch on that one because not everyone got that. So we're going to.
What is this Equestria Girls you speak of?
It has Bruce Wayne to sell toys.
Selective denial. It works great for the people who don't want to agree that there is 3 other Star Wars movies.
What, 3 other Star Wars movies? Now you're just talking crazy talk.
Yeah, I know. It's like the people that say that it's a Star Trek reboot. I don't know what they're talking about.
Yeah.
By the by, I found that stallion that was at Shining Armor's wedding for real.
Oh, cool.
Ooh.
What's his name?
Cherry Fizzy.
Wow.
He is an Earth Pony.
Oh, the Earth Pony.
Yes, Cherry Fizzy has been friends with Shining Armor ever since the first day of basic training, so obviously post-high school. He often takes the train to the Crystal Empire when he's on leave and is very bored because the Crystal Planets don't do anything. Sorry, I'm very bitter. My thing with Cadence and Shining Armor overall, and Flash Sentry, I'll acknowledge him, there's so much potential there.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
There's so much they can do with the Empire, with a newly married couple, with a newly appointed empress and guy who married her.
Mm-hmm.
and yes, even with Flash, he knew character who might be of an interest to one of the main six, you could do stuff with that.
I mean, here's the thing.
Problem is that I will tell you why they are not doing stuff with them is because Hasbro is telling them to sell another different toy with every season.
Oh, true.
So if season four didn't have the Rainbow Power story arc, I'm pretty sure they would have done something with the Crystal Empire.
True.
The problem is that they cannot do anything about it. So I am here hoping that if they cannot expand on the Crystal Empire through the TV show, they might expand on the Crystal Empire through the comics.
Yeah,
they haven't done that yet, but I'm here kind of like high hopes. They have to do something with it. I mean,
they have a lot of potential everywhere. It just depends on where they want to concentrate their assets. Because they are a toy making company, and they, having the rainbow style is just a different paint job for pretty much the same molds, I believe. It's like maximizing whatever they have, which kind of would make sense in a business type of way.
But they
have potential everywhere. You've got the Minotaur lands, you've got the Griffins, you've got
Dragons.
The Crystalponies again, you got the Dragon, Dragons to an extent, but there's so much stuff left and right.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to write an essay to Hasbro saying, I want a playset of Queen Chrysalis's castle with dungeons and like scary stuff, put it to sale, and then make an entire season about it.
And changelings that change color when you dip them in hot water.
Ooh. That's a great idea! Yes, that is so 80s and 90s. The toys that change color when you soak them in water or when you put them under a light.
Yeah, that would be so cool.
You get like random changelings everywhere, and suddenly when you dip them in water, they change color to a pony color, and they're like in disguise.
Oh god, yes. Mm. Oh god, no, better idea. It would be like transformer ponies, so they change from normal pony to changeling like a transformer. Hasbro can do this.
The size.
Or how about start up an adventure pony playset, and all the girls will buy the toys just to have griffins and minotaurs for their tea parties.
Awesome.
Why not?
Why not, indeed?
That is the question. Why not?
Do you guys remember Mighty Max?
Oh, yeah, I do.
Mighty Max, the badass version of Polly Pocket. They should do a Mighty Max version of MLP with, like, tiny pony figurines and in like, pocket-sized playsets that are, like the Crystal Empire one, and then one of the Changelings land, and then one of the Dragon land. Wouldn't it be cool?
Yeah.
So here we are. Here we are doing as fans do, writing the ideas for the company.
True.
And our voices shall go unheard.
Oh well.
Comic. We're not talking about comics anymore.
Yeah, I think we've run the course on that one.
Yeah. But anywho.
Final verdict. Mm-hmm. I think all of us on the Neigh Everything. I love how every single Andy Price and Katie Cook comic has a title. Yeah, it has a title. Neigh Everything, The Return of Queen Chrysalis, Reflections, The Ascent and the Art of Gazebo Reaper. They are so cool when they put titles on their comics.
True.
So, okay, final verdict. I personally loved it. Norman.
I loved it also. I mean, one of the best arc that introduced Shining Armor and Cadence's back history. Love it.
Silver.
On the rare chance you can read this before, you can have a friend rather read this before they see a Camelot wedding, that will be a huge help to them.
Mm-hmm.
And let's face it, the fact that they're married isn't really a spoiler.
Oh, true.
It's kind of a given. But it's a fun comic. It pokes fun at classic tropes. For us older folks, you'll get to have some nostalgia and also have a laugh at your own entertainment history.
True.
And Lion.
Oh, it's an enjoyable comic. It's much better than what could be called professional sometimes nowadays. And yes, definitely, if someone wants to watch some ponies and learn more about the background ponies or their background stories, it's definitely a good read. It's something that's enjoyable. It has a few bit of laughs, and it has some pop culture reference left and right that are really interesting once you get to notice them.
Oh, true. And it's 80s and 90s pop culture, not modern day. So it's really awesome.
All those little things are made for bronies and for adults. Yeah. So it's essentially a family comic, which makes it even more awesome.
Mm-hmm.
It plays it safe in that, I'm going to go into another tangent, but I completely agree on that. Like, it plays it safe because all the pop culture references that it makes, they are timeless pop culture references. They are references that are already deep in the subconscious of every single geek and nerd and fan of anything that has to do with that culture in general. So it, even if it's something very niche, something that is very niche, it's still going to be remembered.
True, true.
Yeah, but they don't delve too much onto the stereotype that could have been there. They could have just played it even more safe or just more dumb and use stereotypes as a scapegoat, but they didn't go that way.
From Katie Cook's interview in one of the Brony Convention panels, when she sent the script to Hasbro to get it approved, she thought she was going to get the script with a lot of changes and red ink and all that, and like, remove this, remove that. They returned the script without a single change, and she was surprised.
I think they love it, that's the thing.
Did they say what the change was?
I think that she was worried about cross-dressing Poindexter.
But that
if
was
it worked for Bugs Bunny, it can work for My Little Pony.
And yeah, but that's the thing, is that this is Hasbro after all. They're like, confused messages. But no, they were like, no, that's fine, that's cool.
Yeah.
We're okay with it.
There was a trope during the 80s and 90s when you'd watch TV shows. So yeah, I mean, it's all good.
Besides, we're about to have a toy where Celestia is wearing goth.
Oh, God, no.
Who are we to criticize?
True that.
I am so happy that thing exists.
Oh, God. What exists? I don't know what you're talking about, James.
It's
Selective denial. Selective denial. Anyway, James, what's the next comic?
Okay, yeah, let's move on to the next comic. So, Norman, the next comic is the Fluttershy Micro Series, written by Barbara Randall Kessel and drawn by Tony Flicks.
Yeah, best pony, yo.
Yeah, right, whatever. I'm not going to argue on that, even though you're wrong. You guys can look for that next week. But for us, it's going to be like a couple of minutes because we're going to record one after the other. I broke the illusion!
No!
yes! They broke the illusion of time and space. Okay, so that's it for the our review on the Princess Cadence and Shining Armor story arc. Mm-hmm. I think this was all over the place, but
indeed,
that kind of like only made it more enjoyable. You guys can put together the review in the order that you guys want. So that's it. And this has been James Corck.
Tack on me by the A-Health. I got no idea that number 3 soundtrack.
That was Stay Norman Sanzo making an ass of himself.
I'm just listening for the second verse.
Tack on me.
No, you don't want to hear me sing. That's just wrong.
Oh, God.
Me. Yeah, my voice is a little hoarse.
Oh!
And that's the Lionheart cartoon doing a bad pun.
You're so much better than the ears, Lion. Come on, no.
We'll see you guys next week. Bye.
I'm gonna go cry in the corner. Goodbye. I'm gonna go lay down on the floor.